Formation Committee for a couple of years now and has put a lot of energy and effort into finding us these great speakers. So let's go.
I've also had the help of a great committee, and Charles has helped tremendously on all of this. We're delighted to see all of you here today. I think we have a real treat in store. Christopher Grasso is going to speak to us on the influence of the unification of church and state during the colonial period. And of course, that very much was the way that people here lived in Williamsburg, were in Bruton Parish, worshiped at the church. It was built in 1715. They were very much shaped by that unification of church and state. I'd like to introduce Christopher Grasso. He is currently a professor of history at the College of William and Mary. He formerly was the editor of the William and Mary Quarterly, which is, of course, published by the Institute of Early American History and Culture at the college. And you were there for 13 years. And a lot of interesting things have passed through that quarterly during that period of time. Professor Grasso received his PhD from Yale University. He's been very interested in journalism, English, and religious studies, and of course, history. And he did receive his PhD from Yale. He's very interested in the colonial period and the early American period up through the Civil War, looking at religious issues to see how people were participating or not participating in structured religion. So I think you'll find his talk very interesting. He's working on two books currently, and I think, excuse me, is there a large hum on this end? I'll move over here, maybe that will help. The two books that he's working on now are Skepticism and American Faith, From the Revolution to the Civil War. And of course, that's a period we're going to be very interested in as we move forward. And then he has a book that sounds fascinating. I can't wait to have it come out. Teacher, Preacher, Soldier, Spy. The Civil War of John K. R. Kelso. And that will be forthcoming, we hope, before too long. Christopher, we're delighted you're here. Thank you for coming.
Well, thank you first for all of you for coming out this evening. And I'd like to thank the Bruton Parish Church Committee and Anne for all her work, inviting me here and including me in this series commemorating the 300th anniversary of Bruton Church. I've been asked to address the question of how the union of church and state affected colonial life and faith. First, I'm going to remove my glasses. You're going to be a little fuzzier now, but this will be clearer. So. I think that'll work. The question of how the union of church and state affected colonial life and faith. In other words, how did colonial Americans think about and experience church establishment? This question reminds me of preparing for a spelling bee back in Miss Umphlett's fourth grade class. We students began to wonder, what was the longest word we knew and could spell? Someone, of course, suggested supercalifragilisticexpialidocious, but that was immediately ruled out of court because that's not a real word. The longest real word any of us had heard of was anti-disestablishmentarianism. Not a particularly hard word to spell, as it turned out. Just begin with the word established, and you stick on things in the front and the back, and you've got it. But so spelling it was one thing, but what did it mean? I don't remember how I found out. In those pre-Google days, I'm sure I had to thumb through a dictionary and, you know, ask my parents and now ask my teacher what it meant, or try to make sense of what I found in the dictionary. I learned that the establishment at the center of the word had to do with the civil government setting up and maintaining a church. passing laws that gave it special privileges and collecting taxes to pay for it. I learned, however, that this had nothing to do with the United States, where the church and state were separate, and we enjoyed something called religious freedom. So, well, there the matter rested for me for many years. I don't think I thought about anti-disestablishmentarianism again for many years after that. And then I eventually learned that the relationship of church and state and its impact on the religious practice of individuals and communities in America is considerably more complicated than that, both after and before the founding of the United States. To get at what church establishment meant to colonial Americans, we first need to grapple with what disestablishment meant in the founding era. For the myths and misunderstandings about what happened in the 1780s tend to distort our view of the colonial era behind it. Two myths often get repeated in the kind of red state, blue state popular culture we have today. A liberal myth and a conservative myth about religion and the American founding. The liberal myth holds that with the ratification of the First Amendment in 1791, Americans built a wall of separation between church and state, starkly separating religion and government. Liberals can therefore invoke the founders against the partisans on the Christian right, who since the 1980s have been trying to tear down that wall. The conservative myth contends that with the First Amendment, the founders only meant that no particular Christian denomination would be established. The Episcopalians, say. Or the Presbyterians. I was expecting you to hiss when I said that. But that the founders presupposed that America would continue to be a Christian nation, with law and government supporting and privileging the religion that was planted at first settlement, and that continued to be the profession of the vast majority of the population. Both of these myths are wrong. Americans tend to forget that the Bill of Rights, initially and until the 20th century, only limited the national government. It had no effect on the relation of religion and government on the state or local levels. The levels of government that had the most effect on people's day-to-day lives in the early American Republic. The Supreme Court did not start applying the strictures of the First Amendment beyond the federal government itself until well into the 20th century. And they did so on the foundation of the Equal Protection Clause of the 14th Amendment, which was ratified after the Civil War. So after 1791, the states had remained free to establish religion and put limitations on its free exercise as they so chose, which is why the Massachusetts Constitution could continue to establish Congregationalism until 1833, and Connecticut until 1818, and New Hampshire until 1819. Nonetheless, although the First Amendment was not enforced upon the states and did not build a wall of separation between church and state, its language was broad and not narrow. And that language represented the trend toward disestablishment in most of the other states. On the eve of the Revolution, 9 of 13 states collected direct taxes for their churches. A decade later, 7 had establishments of some sort. And by the early 1790s, only 3 states, the 3 I just mentioned, Massachusetts, Connecticut, and New Hampshire, actively continued the older arrangement. Broad disestablishment, with Virginia, of course, leading the way, was the new late 18th century trend in most states. And this broad language is reflected in the First Amendment. Not surprising if you know that Madison was the one kind of pulling the strings behind all of this. Senator Elbridge Gerry of Massachusetts had proposed to narrow the scope of the amendment by having it prevent only the preference for one Christian denomination over the others, or to prevent an endorsement of particular articles of faith or modes of worship. But this was rejected for the broad Madisonian form that was ratified. Congress shall make no law respecting the establishment of religion or prohibiting the free exercise thereof. Jackson and Thomas Jefferson had worked together in Virginia to secure passage of the famous Statute on Religious Freedom in 1786. They did so in alliance with many Baptists and some Presbyterians who had been persecuted under the old colonial establishment. These evangelicals were concerned about a single denomination getting power and again oppressing religious minorities. The Baptists especially also wanted to protect their churches from any interference from the state. Jefferson, Madison, and other liberal and enlightened characters in the revolutionary and post-revolutionary leadership wanted to protect the state from the turmoil of the churches. Madison wrote, Madison says a nice line, so these two. Very brief one, but it works for a while. Madison wrote in his 1785 Memorial and Remonstrance, which was against Patrick Henry's bill, the General Assessment Bill, for a tax that would support all the Christian denominations, and not just one church. Madison said, well, we've had a legal establishment of some sort in Christianity, and it's been given a trial for 15 centuries. It's been kind of a long experiment. What have been its fruits? More or less, in all places, he said, pride and indolence in the clergy, ignorance and servility in the laity, in both superstition, bigotry, and persecution. What influence, in fact, have ecclesiastical establishments had on civil society? In some instances, they've been seen to erect a spiritual tyranny on the ruins of the civil authority. And in many instances, they have been seen upholding the thrones of political tyranny. In no instance have they been seen the guardians of the liberties of the people. So political disestablishment was achieved at the national level in 1791, in most states by 1800, and in all of them by 1833. But this did not build a wall of separation between church and state. In the first half of the 19th century, conservative Christians pushed back against what they perceived to be the secularizing tendencies of disestablishment, and they asserted the Christian nation argument. More significant than the ceremonial state endorsements of Christianity that continued even on the federal level, like swearing on a Bible in court or opening Congress with a Christian prayer, that kind of thing. The Christian nation argument was that Christianity had been incorporated into the fabric of American politics and society through the common law. Now, Thomas Jefferson had argued strenuously against this, but by 1832, Supreme Court Justice Joseph Story was proclaiming not only that American government at all levels could, but should show preference for and support of Christianity. The law could and did, for example, prosecute Christian conceptions of blasphemy. This notion that Christianity was legally established despite the constraints imposed by the federal and state constitutions perhaps reached its high water mark around 1850 and was then gradually dismantled in the courts by the end of the 19th century. The retreat from the idea that Protestant beliefs were legally enforceable communal norms coincided with a shift of emphasis among Protestant arguments about religious liberty. Because, you see, by the mid-19th century, Protestants were arguing bitterly with Catholics about religion in the public schools and about religion in politics. And in this Protestant-Catholic argument, the Protestants started to emphasize more and more individualistic notions of religious liberty. So the legal scholar and historian Stephen K. Green, therefore, encourages us not to think of not a single moment of disestablishment, but of three processes. Political disestablishment in the late 18th and early 19th century. Legal disestablishment by the beginning of the 20th century. And then constitutional, and here he means the application of the federal constitution to the people. Constitutional and cultural disestablishment beginning in the 1940s but still not complete. If by complete, we mean that wall of separation that Jefferson, Madison, and perhaps some Virginia Baptists alike had hoped for. So, disestablishment, or the separation of church and state, has been a vexed, complex, and contested process since the American Revolution. The same could be said for establishment, or the union of church and state before 1776. The English colonists who settled in North America came, as Madison had said, with a long history of church establishment. Christianity, of course, began as a Jewish sect within the Roman Empire. The Romans would have more happily tolerated this new cult if Christians had also been willing to pay their respects to the Roman state gods, as well as their own god. See, the Romans didn't mind the stuff about Christ. They just minded that the Christians were snubbing their noses at the Roman gods. The Jews were also an exclusive monotheist in this way, of course, but the Romans gave them a pass because they were an ancient faith. Christians were not, and especially as the Christians pulled away from the Jews, they stood out more as this kind of wild new cult and opened themselves to persecution. After Christianity itself became the established religion of the Roman Empire in the 4th century, non-Christian religious minorities were persecuted. Protestant reformers in the 16th century, I'm leaping really quickly across these centuries. Protestant reformers in the 16th century struggled against the Catholic Church by holding up the rights of individual conscience against church authority. But Luther and Calvin weren't empowering conscience for its own sake, allowing individuals to follow wherever the inner voice might lead. They assumed that conscience, once freed from the corruptions of the Catholic Church, would lead to the singular truths that they saw in the Bible. It didn't turn out this way. Once you start giving the vernacular Bible to people and letting them read it, they started to have their own interpretations of it. Others ended up reading their Bibles differently, and when they deviated too far from the orthodoxy established by Protestant states, Protestants became persecutors too. Religious refugees from 17th century England tried to balance the rights of conscience and the duties of the Christian community when they planted settlements in the New World. Both John Winthrop and Roger Williams fled what they perceived to be the Church of England's lingering Catholic corruption, and that established Church's persecution of pious dissenters. Winthrop's famous lay sermon, A Model of Christian Charity, delivered aboard ship before the Puritans left England in 1630, spoke of a community of Christians, rich and poor, high and low, bound together by a vision of Christian truth and the bonds of Christian love. By mutual consent, they would join together under a form of government, both civil and ecclesiastical, he preached. In such cases as these, the care of the public must oversway all private respects. Both conscience and civil polity, he said, would bind them to the work of Christian community. For this end, we must be knit together in this work as one man. We must entertain each other in brotherly affection. We must be willing to abridge ourselves of our superfluities for the supply of others' necessities. We must uphold the familiar commerce together in all meekness, gentleness, patience, and liberality. We must delight in each other, make each other's conditions our own, rejoice together, mourn together, labor and suffer together, always having before our eyes our commission and community in the work as members of the same body. Winthrop did not object that the Church of England was established and supported by the state. He objected to the particular doctrines and practices it enforced. New England would be a better establishment. Not because less coercive, but because better aligned with God's truth. A truth that Christian consciences would acknowledge if those consciences, he thought, were rightly informed by the Bible. But But what of Puritans who dissented from the rules that this Puritan civil and ecclesiastical government set up? Just 7 years after Winthrop had described his model of Christian charity, Anne Hutchinson was on trial in the Bay Colony. Governor Winthrop charged her with saying diverse things very prejudicial to the honor of the churches and ministers in Massachusetts. In her defense, Hutchinson said she did so as a matter of conscience. Winthrop answered, "Your conscience you must keep, or it must be kept for you." Anne Hutchinson was banished. Later in the century, dissident Quakers, including Mary Dyer, who had been one of Hutchinson's followers, met a worse fate. Massachusetts hanged them. Now, Roger Williams had come to New England within a year of Winthrop, and with similar dreams of a godly community. But within a few years, he had concluded that the Massachusetts Union of Church and State was nearly as bad as England's. He became an eloquent defender of the rights of conscience against coercive religious community established by law. "The conscience he referred to," he wrote, "is found in all mankind, more or less. In Jews, Turks, Papists, Protestants, and pagans. And he argued that 'tis impossible for any man or men to maintain their Christ by their sword and to worship the true Christ. In fighting against all consciences opposed to their own," he said, "they in some degree or another were fighting against God." Well, New England, except for Williams's Rhode Island, established Puritan Congregationalism. The region was settled by middling families, many of whom shared the dreams of a godly community, and those who dissented from Puritan rule were encouraged to go elsewhere. Virginia shared little with New England besides religious establishment and a white population that was, relative to other English colonies, religiously and ethnically homogeneous. Virginians established the Church of England and in the 17th and early 18th centuries promoted a somewhat different ideal of the union of church and state. Now, although the settlers of Jamestown built a chapel within a few years of settlement, it was hard to practically, as opposed to legally, establish and sustain Anglican worship. What with a population heavily tilted toward young male indentured servants, think of a frat house, a frat house where people die a lot, unfortunately, a high death rate, a dispersed settlement pattern, and few clergymen. But things eventually in Virginia settled down by the late 17th century, and the colony experienced something of an Anglican Renaissance. As Robert Beverly's history noted in 1705, parishes had a convenient church, built either of timber, brick, or stone, decently adorned with everything necessary for the celebration of divine service. The appeal of this state church religion in colonial Virginia has been well described by the historian Jules Spangler. "The church could effectively explain life's mysteries and make the range of human experience tolerable and comprehensible for those who participated. It gave adherents a way to grieve and rejoice, to cope with hardship and to situate themselves in creation. The readings and sermons not only offered an explanation for how the world and the heavens worked and demanded tolerance for that which could not be explained, but they also had a prescriptive quality. They gave parishioners directions about how to live their lives, what their goals should be, and how to address the conflicts and challenges they faced. Sunday services offered an important contrast to the mundane realities of everyday life as well. Services took adherents out of their ordinary surroundings and their usual experiences and brought them into touch with something different and unearthly that allowed them to experience a connection with something larger than themselves. The process of worship connected them to the cycle of years and the seasons while directing their attention heavenward. Entering the Anglican Church building itself, as much as hearing the readings and sermons, could put Virginians in unfamiliar emotional territory, inspiring awe, discomfort, and reverence. Now, in New England at this time, the church buildings were much plainer and less adorned than your beautiful church building here. And worship without the Book of Prayer was focused more on long sermons. But for many, the effect was the same. In Virginia, as in New England, the whole community gathered together to worship God. What did the union of church and state mean to colonial Americans? For these supporters of the Paris Church in Virginia and New England, it meant that ministers, magistrates, and all the people in a particular place worshiped God together as part of a single organic community. In New England, many town churches were torn apart in the 1740s by divisive religious revivals, which pitted new lights who endorsed the excitement of the revivals as the work of God against old lights who denounced all this overwrought emotionalism as a kind of madness that was staining the cause of true religion. In Virginia, the ideal of a single parish community bound together by Anglican practice was disrupted first by Presbyterians in the 1750s and more starkly by separate Baptists in the 1760s. The Baptists in particular came with a very different religious style, evangelical, emotional, populist, and an implicit challenge to local Anglican elites. Some of these local leaders responded violently to what they perceived of as an attack on the good order of their church and their society. A 1771 diary entry by a Baptist named John Williams records one such incident. Brother Waller informed us that about 2 weeks ago on the Sabbath day down in Caroline County, he introduced the worship of God by singing. While he was singing, the parson of the parish, who had ridden up with his clerk, the sheriff, and some others, would keep running the end of his horsewhip in Waller's mouth, laying his whip across the hymn book, etc. When done singing, Waller proceeded to prayer. In it, he was violently jerked off the stage. They caught him by the back part of his neck, beat his head against the ground, sometimes up, sometimes down. They carried him through the gate, which stood some considerable distance, where a gentleman, the sheriff, gave him 20 lashes with a horsewhip. Then Brother Waller was released, went back singing praise to God, mounted the stage, and preached with a great deal of liberty. Some colonies lacked a religious establishment altogether. William Penn was a Quaker, and Quakers would come to dominate Pennsylvania politics, but the Quaker meeting was not the colony's established church. Penn's holy experiment was to be based upon the liberty of conscience, the freedom of a person to worship God as he saw fit, as long as he stayed within the bounds of morality and maintained no principle hurtful to his neighbor in his civil property. Pennsylvania became much more religiously and ethnically diverse than colonies in New England or in the South. So many Germans came, for example, that Benjamin Franklin was worried by the middle of the 18th century that it was becoming a bilingual society. The middle colonies, Pennsylvania, New York, Delaware, New Jersey, had to come to terms with American pluralism sooner than most places to the north and south of them. So what would the union of church and state have meant to Pennsylvanians? It would have threatened the end of the holy experiment, which had allowed separate religious communities to worship without state interference. In the middle of the 18th century, many Protestants, pacifists, Quakers aside, I'm aside for a moment, embraced a different form of the union of church and state. This was less about tax support and legal privileges, and more about ideological interconnectedness between Britishness and what they considered to be true Christianity. The Seven Years' War, after all, the French and Indian War, pitted Protestant Britain against Catholic France in a struggle for the dominion over North America. British American preachers rail against the twin tyranny of France's absolutist monarchy and a papacy that was nothing less than the Antichrist described in the Book of Revelation. British Protestantism, on the other hand, was the standard bearer for civil and ecclesiastical liberty in the world. Britain's constitutional monarchy prevented tyranny, they thought. Its balanced constitution allowed the people a voice in their own government. Protestantism protected every person's right to read the Bible and consult their consciences. And the British Constitution ensured that Britain would be Protestant. When the British were victorious at Quebec in 1760, some ministers got so excited that they thought Christ's millennial reign on earth might be beginning. British American Catholics in Maryland, one suspects, could cheer their country's victory, but only roll their eyes at such Protestant prophesying. With peace, local concerns returned to the fore. A Scots-Irish Presbyterian coming to settle in Massachusetts, for example, might be greeted warmly as a fellow traveler by the similarly Calvinist Congregationalists there. And therefore, he might see the New England church-state arrangement as benign. This same fellow might be viewed with suspicion, however, in Anglican Virginia, and thus think differently about that colony's establishment. Baptists resented state-sanctioned harassment by Congregationalists in New England, and they resented state-sanctioned harassment by Anglicans in Virginia. New England Congregationalists in the 1760s and 1770s, though they were established and favored in their own region, were really worried that Anglican calls for colonial bishops were part of Britain's increasing attempts to deprive colonists of their rights. It was all part of a conspiracy, they're starting to think, in the 1760s. Calling the bishop, raising our taxes, all part of the same thing. They liked their own church-state union, but they feared a different one. Britain's gentle toleration of Catholics in Canada with the Quebec Act in 1774 only heightened such fears. Look how nice Britain is being to Catholics? French Catholics? What's going on here? Maybe Britain is corrupt. After all. So, how did colonists experience the union of church and state? It depends on which colonists. It depends on where you look. The American Revolution heightened the argument for the religious rights of individuals and the rights of dissenting minority communities within any polity. Such ideals, together with the fact of American pluralism, and the historical experience that by now had showed them that people of different faiths could indeed live together, ended church establishment in the new United States. A wall did not spring up between religion and politics. Few would have gone as far as Thomas Jefferson in Notes on the State of Virginia, who wrote that it does me no injury for my neighbor to say that there are 20 gods or no god. It neither picks my pocket nor breaks my leg. Most Protestants in the late 18th century hoped and expected that the United States would be shaped by Protestant values, even without the aid of formal establishment. Their embrace of pluralism could only comfortably stretch to include different Protestant denominations. They knew they'd have to accommodate individual Catholics, the power of the Catholic Church as individual Catholics, and Jews, although perhaps we have to prevent the latter from holding state offices, as some constitutions did. A polyglot polity, including the range of religious and non-religious beliefs we have today, was probably beyond the grasp of their imaginations. But disestablishmentarianism was only the beginning of the American exploration of religious freedom.
Thank you so much for that most enlightening and stimulating talk. We greatly appreciate you coming here tonight. Would you be able to perhaps entertain a few questions?
Absolutely. I mean, I have answers, but I can do a dance for them or something.
That's right. That would be a good thing to do.
Way in the back.
I have a question. Thomas Jefferson's Bible is all cut up. He cut out things he didn't agree with.
Right.
And can you speak a little bit about where he was coming from and what he believed and the whole Bill of Rights? I mean, it's interesting.
Yes, well, Thomas Jefferson was a deist. He believed in a creator. He did not believe in the miracles of the New Testament, and that's why he cut up his Bible. He thought that, well, there's a lot of really good stuff in here. He admired Christian ethics. This is great, but it's got all this miracles and all this other stuff, this superstition. You know, we can rationalize the Bible by taking our scissors to it and cutting out the incrustations that had gathered on this scripture over the centuries. Get it back to what was really true. Thomas Jefferson also famously predicted in the 1820s that, you know, in another generation, all Americans will be Unitarian. There's a guy that really had his pulse. You know, he's bigger on the pulse of the nation, right? Evangelicals are going wild around him, but it's, no. You know, he thought that with education and with, you know, the increased rationality of the American people, that they would become good, rational Unitarians, and that's where things were heading. There's a very interesting exchange of letters with President Thomas Cooper at South Carolina College, and Cooper's saying, you know, I don't fix it. You know, I look around and I see like the Methodists are, you know, firing people up with this emotional language, and maybe the elites, maybe the, you know, the intellectuals will be Unitarians, but everybody else is going to be Methodists or they're going to be Baptists. Cooper was not crazy about that either. Yes?
To address the Mid-Atlantic region during this time period, starting with Maryland and working north to New York?
Well, I just kind of glanced quickly at the middle colonies with their ethnic and religious diversity. Maryland, of course, is a very interesting case. Initially founded as a refuge for Catholics, very quickly, many more Protestants came to settle Maryland, so you had tensions between the Catholics and the Protestants there in the state. So, although in many ways, you know, socially they are similar to Virginia, that religious dynamic is different. New York is initially settled by the Dutch. Of course, the English take over. The Dutch had lots of experience with their own religious toleration in different places around the world, where they really had to realize, less out of principle, I think, than just out of the facts on the ground. You had Jews, you had Protestants, you had Catholics, you had all these different religions, and they had to find a way to all live together. The Dutch had experience with that. So there was kind of a tradition of toleration for religious diversity kind of coming with the Dutch. When the English took over, they had to kind of incorporate the Dutch in the Hudson River Valley. The Church of England was established in some counties of New York, not in other counties. So there too, and as in New Jersey, Pennsylvania, what you get is what historians like to pull out the mosaic metaphor. It's a mosaic. It's not a melting pot. No one talks about the melting pot anymore. It's a mosaic. You have a German Lutheran community in Pennsylvania, and then there's a German Reformed community, and then there are the Moravians over here, and then you have the Anglicans and the Presbyterians and the Baptists and the Quakers, and they're all not mixing together necessarily, but coexisting side by side.
In Massachusetts, didn't the Puritans try to ban the Baptists or chase them out?
Yeah, well, they didn't like the Baptists. They didn't like non-Puritans other than the way they defined them. The problem was, and as I said, when the Quakers kept coming back, Mary Dyer, you know, they kicked her out. By the fourth time, they said, oh, no, we're going to hang her. That should make a statement. This got them in trouble with, you know, the crown across the ocean, because, you know, the crown was saying, you know, we have to be more tolerant. You can't hang these people anymore. But yes, they didn't. That's why they called Rhode Island the cesspool of New England. That's what Massachusetts Puritans thought, because that's where you live. Just get them out. Go to Rhode Island. If you don't want to stay here, go to Rhode Island. Baptists, Quakers, separates, anything. Just go away.
Yes. The states that colonies that extracted taxes for church, how did they decide how that was distributed?
different ways in different places. And for example, Congregationalism in New England was very locally oriented. There's no authority higher than each local congregation. So it's the local town that raises money. It's tax dollars at the town level. And those are distributed to the parish church. And now in Virginia, the Church of England, it's a different story. Because you have glebe lands, you've got the larger church apparatus. You don't have bishops, but you still have this larger connectedness of the individual parishes, which you don't have in Massachusetts. That's why when you get to the revolutionary period, they start to think, okay, if we can't do it the old way, that was Patrick Henry's plan for a general assessment. Okay, we know we can't just have the Church of England established anymore. That's not going to work. But can we still at least collect a tax and distribute it to all the Christian denominations, or at least all the ones we like? You know, not some of the wilder ones, but you know, just, and that's what Madison, with his remonstrance, was arguing against, and that's where he kind of got the Baptists on board to say, no, this isn't going to work either. That's just going to lead down the same road again. What we want is complete religious liberty, and so they dismantle that. And a lot of the arguments in Virginia kind of set the trend. Or influential in other states, and also, I think, affect the framing of the First Amendment.
Yes. I've been told that the British made a major political mistake in North America, in Virginia in particular, on not permitting a bishop to come onto this soil, and they kept the church somewhat English and allowed the variety of development that occurred. Any reaction? Have you heard that?
Oh, yeah. The colonial Anglicans thought that very much. You see petitions. You see petitions in 1701 and 1702. You see petitions again. Send us a bishop. We need a bishop. Send a bishop over here because, you know, that will help. It'll help control the churches. It'll help monitor the clergy. You'll be able to ordain clergy. It'll be almost automatically a college will form around a bishop. You know, people come study with them. We need a bishop. And of course, the other denominations freak out every time that happens. They especially freak out in the 1760s. But it really, really made them nervous because they thought that this is oppression. You send over a bishop, and that is the power of the state coming down and supporting even more than it does now. Because as I'm sure you all know, in Virginia, the local vestrymen, the local gentry were the ones calling the shots. And they liked it that way. They didn't necessarily, you know, lay Anglicans did not necessarily want a bishop because they liked that having that power on the local level. But other clergymen wanted a bishop. So you had resistance from lay Anglicans, but you had lots of resistance from other denominations who did not want the English state putting its money and its power behind a colonial bishop. So there were some who made that argument, but there are lots of other ones who didn't. Yes?
Was there any discussion about once the state church was disestablished, who would be providing welfare for orphans, widows, or who would be administering poorhouses to provide food for children?
Well, that becomes a problem. It's usually run by local charities anyway, and it was thought that the churches would just continue to do that. In places like the cities were gaining population in the 18th century, like Boston, New York, and so on, the private church-sponsored charities are very quickly overwhelmed and can't handle it anymore. And so the states have to say, something's got to be done here. We've got to do something about this. So you know, urban poverty really becomes a problem. And so money, in those instances, well, you know, there was no establishment in Philadelphia anyway. But money that could have conceivably been kind of funneled through the church for those purposes couldn't be. So the state had to then design other ways to address those needs, which were especially acute in the cities. Yes?
I don't know exactly when Washington, the Capitol, District of Columbia, and the buildings were built. But in the Supreme Court, there's the Ten Commandments, I think, behind the court, and these religious references in federal buildings. What justify that being done?
Well, there's a lot of, even with Jefferson, who's the most, and he's the one that gives us this whole language of the wall of separation between church and state. That comes from Thomas Jefferson's letter to the Danbury Baptists in about 1802. And the Supreme Court takes that in the 1940s and uses that to interpret the First Amendment. This is what the First Amendment means, because Thomas Jefferson said so. Maybe not. But there was a lot of continuity, even in the Jefferson administration, of like ceremonial things like that, having the Ten Commandments, having the government paid for chaplains in the military, Protestant chaplains, or opening Congress with a prayer. Those kinds of things are continuing. Now, the Jeffersonian presidents, Jefferson, Addison, Monroe, I think even all the way up through Andrew Jackson, did not call for national fast days and things like that. And Jefferson said, that is not our, we shouldn't be doing that. That's crossing a line. They did it, state governors did it all the time, especially in New England. Less so in the South. So, different states would draw a different line about what's going too far, and the national government, especially those with more, the presidents with more Jeffersonian sensibilities, didn't do things like that. But there are still plenty of examples like that, where it shows kind of a, if not an official establishment, at least as kind of support for Protestantism, Christianity in general.
Yes. When Jefferson became president, made sure that he was on the first Board of Education for the District of Columbia. Do you know about this?
Yeah.
His choice of, the first meeting they asked, what should we use for the elementary school primer? And it was Jefferson. He said, Bible and the hymnal. Because then they'll learn to read and learn morality. And he specified which Bible and which hymnal.
Yeah, and he didn't even tell them to take their scissors to it.
No.
Cut out the miracles and stuff.
Yeah, yeah.
Jefferson was a politician too, not just an Enlightenment figure. So, and he was very, Jefferson was hammered by the Federalist opposition in the election of 1800 as an atheist. And you should, the rhetoric, you think our political rhetoric is bad today. You should read the stuff around 1800. It's like, lock up your daughters, folks, because this guy's going to steal your Bibles, and it's going to be revolutionary France here if you elect him. There's going to be blood in the streets, wheel out the guillotines, the whole thing. They're like, he's an atheist, and he's going to, take this country down the path of revolutionary France, and again and again and again. And Jefferson didn't like that, obviously, but he tried to be very careful to keep most of his deistic opinions private to himself, and try not to alienate the mass of his supporters, which were, after all, Christians, a lot, especially Baptists, evangelicals voted for him, because they see Jefferson, not as Jefferson the deist, or certainly not Jefferson the atheist, but mostly these Baptists and Presbyterians and so on, and Episcopalians, who voted for Jefferson, see him as the author of the statute on religious freedom in Virginia. He helped us. He helped us get out from under the thumb of the old Anglican Church. He's for religious freedom, and we're for religious freedom. Yes?
Isn't there a distinction, however, between the Christian deists of Jefferson's day and what we understand the deists today? Deists today are more in denial than Jefferson was of Christianity.
There was a range of deism even then, with some who just have kind of this distant watchmaker God who sets the world in motion and then doesn't touch anything, and is almost really just kind of an abstract, like a first cause, is a little more than that. And others who embraced Christian morality, had great respect for Christian ritual and just kind of stayed away, didn't believe that Jesus was the Son of God or any of those things. So deism was not a church. It didn't have doctrines that anybody voted on. It's just a kind of a label that people applied to themselves and others applied to them, but there was considerable variety within that. And your general point that more of the 18th century deists were more friendly to Christianity than someone assuming that term now would be, I think, is right. Although the Christians said the deists were not religious at all. They said, no. We're not letting you into our tent. This was part of the politics of the 1790s too. Deism is really atheism in disguise. Deism is infidelity. You're just playing a game. That's not, you're not real. You're not really religious. And the deists would say, yes, we are. We believe in God. We believe in morality. No, no, you're not. So it became an argument about what real religion was, too. And what, you know, what kind of real religion could be freely exercised in this new republic. One more.
Other than keeping their heads down, what were the Jewish communities at that time doing?
There were very few. Yeah. Keeping their heads down is probably a good description of that. There are Jews in the South, there are Jews in many different places, but there's anti-Semitism, there's prejudice against them, but there is, almost as I was describing the Roman Empire, there is some sense of, you know, their ancient faith. They are, you know, did have something to do with the origins of Christianity after all. So there is some respect. I mean, Ezra Stiles in Newport, Rhode Island, for example, is trying to teach himself Hebrew, and he would go down the street and meet with the rabbi there to help learn the language, and there's sort of kind of an intellectual interchange there, even though they starkly disagreed about anything, especially religion. So there is some discussion, some talk between these two, but I think keeping their head down is probably a good way to put it.
We can't thank you enough for what you've given us tonight in your discussion. It's been a very exciting evening. Thank you so very much.